Hello, I'm Dan Sweeney, the director of the Institute for Enterprise Ethics at the Daniels College of Business here on the University of Denver campus. I am pleased to present the sixth edition of the Institute's quarterly ethics review. This program features several outstanding faculty members from the Daniels College of Business discussing a number of the most interesting and widely reported stories from the world of corporate ethics and responsibility from the previous 3 months. In this session, we will talk about the Volkswagen emission testing case, the FIFA bribery case, the prescription drug pricing issue, and several other questions. My colleagues for this discussion are three outstanding members of the Daniels faculty. Professor Lorenzo Patelli is associate professor in the School of Accountancy. Professor Tricia Olson is associate professor in the Department of Business Ethics and Legal Studies. Professor Bud Bilanek is an adjunct professor in the Department of Management. So let's get on with the discussion. It has been reported for several months now that Volkswagen engineers modified the software on several models of their diesel engines so that they would operate differently when being tested than when they were being driven on the roads, thus reporting lower levels of toxic emissions. The special software was apparently installed on over 11 million cars over a number of years. This was clearly an intentional and quite blatant attempt to deceive regulators as well as to deceive some 11 million customers. Volkswagen senior executives said that no one at Volkswagen was aware of the special software except some engineers. The new CEO described the situation as a, quote, technical, end quote, problem, not an ethical issue. Bud, what do you think? Merely a technical engineering issue or a genuine corporate strategy motivated by the drive for VW to become the largest automobile producer in the world? And if the latter, how does an otherwise very well-respected global corporation find itself doing such a thing?
Well, I do think it's the latter, Dan. I'm pretty convinced just by the fact that Volkswagen executives, including the CEO, will refer to the software as a defeat device. And if you think about that, what they're really admitting is that they are attempting to defeat the emissions control issues involved with their diesel engines. So I think it really is a corporate issue that goes well beyond just a technical issue. And I think that there's probably a couple reasons that I can tell that this has come up. I think that, you know, for one, Volkswagen has really been trying to drive to become the number one car maker in the world. And if you're going to do that, you need to be very strong in the U.S. market. Their strategy seemed to be that they were going to go hard on diesel in the U.S. market, which they did. And they installed these defeat devices, which essentially led people who were buying diesel engines, cars with diesel engines, to think that they were being environmentally conscious when in fact they actually weren't. So it's hard to imagine how a company could lose its way so quickly. To me, the intentionality here is really a huge issue because it's so different than like the ignition switch with General Motors or the rapid acceleration with Toyota, which was a technical problem that was unanticipated. Now, the response from both General Motors and Toyota may not have been as quick or as probably ethical as I would like to have seen, but at least they didn't knowingly install faulty ignition switches, nor did they install faulty rapid acceleration problem. They didn't do that knowingly. So the intentionality here is what I think is really a big issue. I think also you get into the idea of corporate culture. Volkswagen is a very hierarchical organization. And as such, it's hard for people to raise issues within the company if they think that there's something wrong. Germany, from my travels there and from my work there with some U.S.-based companies, but in Germany and with their German operations, one of the things I've also noticed is that it's a fairly hierarchical society. I think it makes it a little harder in both the Volkswagen situation and in the situation just of Germany itself to find people like Sharon Watkins at Enron or Cynthia Cooper at WorldCom who came forward and actually were whistleblowers. So I think a whole number of things contributed there, and not the least of which is their board, which is basically made up of insiders. And I think that one of the best ways to keep a company acting ethically is to have some solid outside directors on the board who can really hold the operating executive's feet to the fire. So I do think it was intentional. I think it's very sad because I do think that Volkswagen has a reputation as a fairly reputable company. And I think that they are doubling down now because a recent article in the New York Times, the new CEO basically was saying, well, the defeat devices may have been illegal in the United States, but it's debatable as to whether they are illegal in the EU. I find that somewhat bizarre when we go back to the whole idea of calling the device itself a defeat device. So I think it's a very, very sad situation for Volkswagen on a whole number of fronts. And I think it's also beyond the ethical situation. It's opened them up to a whole bunch of liability, both from regulators in the U.S. who can demand fines and also from class actions suits that they may find from consumers who brought the product that was advertised in a misleading way.
I agree that it points to an ethical issue, not a technical problem. I would like to offer a European perspective on this. My home country is Italy, so I spent quite a bit of time in Europe. And since 2008, in Europe, we have been dealing with a huge fragmentation in the European Union, and we have told that we had two kind of countries in Europe, the virtuous economies, and Germany was definitely part of this group, and the free riders or the cheaters, and those were other countries. Well, here we have the largest German company, which is basically involved in a big international unethical scandal. And to me, that's problematic for two reasons. One is the problem of the European Union is the international competitiveness of its firms. And this case, to me, shows how a blind competition which does not rely on collaboration and cooperation among businesses is flawed and unsuccessful and maybe unethical. And and second, I think it's actually very interesting that the German corporate governance system, which is quite a unique, is showing this problem. So 20% of Volkswagen is owned by the local state, and by law, a big portion of the board members are elected by the employees or are a representation of the workers. So I'm wondering how such a democratic board was involved in such an opportunistic behavior. So this opens questions that are very interesting from a business perspective. The last thing I want to talk about is my frustration in seeing how the company is actually dealing with this problem. Last week, the newly appointed CEO visited the United States, and apparently it was a disaster in terms of communication and in terms of the only imperative that Volkswagen has right now, which is rebuilding trust. Trust with the customers, trust with financial markets, and trust with the authorities. It seemed that the CEO, again, was corrected later by the company. A lot of the statements that he made had to be clarified by the company. So it is kind of puzzling that, again, the board is supporting the CEO. On Tuesday, he reconfirmed the support to this new CEO. But it seems that they have really an issue here with the rebuilding trust, that it's the thing that they have to do. I just want to mention one little episode that was interesting to me. On January 5th, the stock price of Volkswagen collapsed by 6% because some investors, or some analysts, I should say, miscalculated the amount of the fine that Volkswagen is likely to pay from, I think it was 80 billion down to 45 billion. That was the probable number. Now, this created, again, an emotional reaction on the market that is not helping anybody. It's not helping the shareholders of the Volkswagen company. It's not helping its customer. It's, you know, retrieving the money that they lost in buying these cars. It's not helping rebuilding trust with the financial market. So I think that regardless of where this unethical issue happened, if it happened at board level or management level or at the engineering unit, Volkswagen right now should focusing on rebuilding the trust, and it's puzzling that it's not happening, in my opinion.
Tricia, what do you think?
Yeah, I would just say there's a couple of things. You know, I mean, you've hit on the governance issues here. You've also talked a little bit about the importance of the overall culture within Volkswagen, but then also potentially within Germany. But the piece that I think I would agree with Lorenzo is this idea that the way Volkswagen is reacting to this crisis sort of indicates that there's not a lot of self-realization happening within the company. It strikes me as odd, as Lorenzo was saying, that the chief executive doesn't, you know, he was quoted as saying that it was a technical issue, not an ethical issue, and had to backtrack on that point. I think for other companies wondering what the price of a reputation is, though, I would suggest it's about 30%, which is what the stock price dropped within a five-day period after this scandal broke. And so, you know, thinking about how consumers and the market in general responds to these sorts of crises, you know, it's quite evident to me that people do care. And when they feel as though they've been misled, they'll react accordingly. So I think it's sort of a cautionary tale potentially for other companies out there who may have something like this happening within their companies, and potentially it would give some additional fodder or confidence to would-be whistleblowers who are seeing something like this happening within their own firms.
If I can add a 2 cents or 3 cents to this, the thing that bothers me most about the way the company is responding to this is in however long this has been going on, 8 months, 10 months, we have yet to hear anything from Volkswagen company saying, we're going to do whatever it takes to correct the organizational behavior that allows this sort of thing to go on. It's not just about fixing the technical software. It's about fixing the organizational behavior, because somehow or another in that organization has become okay to deceive customers and investors and regulators. And I think until they get to making public pronouncements and being held accountable for fixing that situation, trust will be a long reach for them.
You know, Dan, one of the things I think that's very interesting about what you're saying, and also what you were saying, is that there is this tremendous loss of trust and faith. And at least here in the U.S., you know, we always like to see the mighty fall, but we also tend to be quite forgiving if, in fact, they fall on their sword and say, yeah, I'm really sorry, we really messed up. And I think, Tricia, that's a big point that you're making, and Dan, to a certain extent, you too, that Volkswagen, from just a public relations standpoint, is handling this so poorly because of they could generate a lot of goodwill. Instead, they seem to be generating more ill will because of the way they seem to be trying to split hairs and talk about, is it technically illegal or is it ethical or unethical? And so I think they're really missing a great opportunity here to do some repair work to their already damaged reputation.
Well, you know, I think that this case is going to go on for a while, so we may have the opportunity to come back and revisit it now and then over the next several months. Thanks. So, Lorenzo, on May 27th, seven then-current FIFA officials, FIFA being the Fédération Internationale de Football Association, were arrested at a five-star hotel in Zurich, Switzerland. They were preparing to attend the 65th FIFA conference, which was scheduled to include the re-election of the president of the FIFA organization. These seven officials are expected to be extradited to the United States on suspicion of receiving $150 million in bribes. Since then, more than 40 defendants have been charged by the United States Justice Department in this continuing corruption case. The charges encompass 24 nationalities, most of them in North, Central, and South America. Sepp Blatter, the then president of FIFA for the past 18 years, told the Wall Street Journal that, quote, he had no knowledge of wrongdoing inside FIFA and its member confederations, end quote. Yet he resigned his post as president very shortly thereafter. So Lorenzo, this is an extremely widespread scandal. It involves huge sums of money paid to individual officials. How is it possible that FIFA's long-term president knew nothing about it, as he claims, and that their ethics committee, yes, they had an ethics committee, apparently did not either, or did they? Which, of course, would raise some even more interesting questions.
Yeah, it was very hard to follow the collapse or the evidence that we know now about FIFA throughout these last almost 12 months now, for three reasons. One is the people involved are not just bureaucrats or officials, but some of them are former soccer players. And I grew up, honestly, with my older brother having posters and stickers about Michel Platini, who was the head of the European Federation of Soccer Teams. And he was supposed to be the next president after Blatter, but he got involved in the scandal in November. October. But so it was very hard just because we have again to witness the fact that people in leadership, people with power, are associated with corruption and unethical behavior. And this is just not good for the society at large. And second, it's a very interesting area of the problem that is emerging and has been emerging lately, is the fact that we are finding out that the poor countries, poor economies, have been paying a higher price for this, and so there is also that other aspect that makes the story hard to follow and hard to see developing. Let me recap a little bit the facts that mark the development of this FIFA scandal. At the end of 2010, Russia and Qatar win the rights to host the World Cup, and especially the win of Qatar was very controversial because not only Qatar seemed to lack the infrastructure necessary to host the most followed sport event in the world, more than the Olympics, but second, because the World Cup typically takes place in the summer, and Qatar is in the desert, and so a soccer player will have to play in with very, very high temperature, which makes it almost impossible to play. So later on, there was also the decision to move the World Cup from the summer to the winter, which was another unprecedented decision by the FIFA that apparently overlooked this issue when the initial decision was made. But I also point to this fact because the role of Qatar is, in my opinion, an example of what's going on with the scandal of FIFA. Qatar, through Qatar Airways, becomes in 2012 the main sponsor of Barcelona, which is one of the best soccer team in the world and has the best soccer player in the world, which is Messi. And so it starts this rise to the power within the world of soccer. After that, Qatari government owned Al Jazeera, or formerly known as Al Jazeera, strike a deal to have the rights to broadcast the French League and the Champions League for 4 years in a multi-million dollar contract. And similarly, a Qatar investment company basically takes ownership in Paris Saint-Germain, which is another very prestigious soccer team that had some financial trouble. So this to me is an example or a sign of what's going on in the scandal of FIFA. This role of Qatar culminated with the arrest and the accusation to one of their main official that was running for the office of the president to be involved again in bribery. He was basically caught handing out money to other FIFA officials to support his candidacy. So this points to the fact that what we are seeing with FIFA is a little bit bigger than just simply a few people involved in a little bribery scandal. This is a geopolitical battle to own the leadership role within the soccer world. And it points to other tensions that we are seeing in other segments of the society related to this international business issue and how to run an international organization like this. And from a point, from a business standpoint, to me, this points to three kind of open issues that could also be used for our discussion today. The first one is the lack of accountability, primarily, in my opinion, due to the fact that FIFA does not have practically owners. You know, nobody owns FIFA, and therefore there is a huge issue there in terms of accountability. The second, as was mentioned in the question, is the 18-year tenure of the president. That in business is very unusual. It's something that we know that it's not healthy for the organization. And so FIFA seemed to have a corporate governance, we would call it, issue. And so looking at the board composition and looking at the rules to elect the board, it would be another interesting area to investigate further. And the last aspect that that I want to mention is, how can we clean up an organization like that? How can we clean up a mess like that? How can we affect the organizational culture, can affect the culture that is obviously toxic at FIFA right now with somebody coming from FIFA itself? So I don't know what's going to happen next month with the election of the new president, which is scheduled, I think, February 27. But it will be interesting to observe how an organization tackle an issue like this with people that were part of this culture for so long and for so many years.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great overview. The three things I would sort of highlight, one is that this is an industry issue. We know that there's all sorts of concerns around transparency and corruption and money in sports generally, not only with FIFA and the World Cup, but also in the Olympic committees, we see these issues as well. So it seems to be something distinct, I guess, potentially with the star power or celebrity factor that comes to play with this particular industry. The other thing I would say is just this key issue that Lorenzo brought up with regards to global governance. FIFA isn't owned by anybody, right? And so it's not unique in dealing with these issues. There are lots of organizations now in public-private partnerships and multi-stakeholder initiatives that are forming within specific industries to try to regulate or self-govern those industries. And so FIFA is butting up against some of the issues that are seen elsewhere with regards to regulating and creating standards that are widely accepted across an industry that really doesn't have a regulatory home, we could say. And so it was interesting, actually, I found a couple of quotes from a transparency expert who quit FIFA's Independent Governance Committee in 2013. And it was fascinating, right? She notes that Blatter likes to keep things within the FIFA family. so indicating this issue of governance is an important one. And she said that when we proposed independent members on the executive committee, the response wasn't just disinterest, it was horror to think that somebody would come from the outside. And so, you know, her point was that even though there were experts on the committee, that there was sort of an incentive to want to stay. People wanted to be affiliated with FIFA and the World Cup. And so, you know, the extent to which they felt like they could, they were acting as independent external monitors was compromised. And then the last thing I would say, you know, Lorenzo mentioned Qatar and the World Cup in 2020, that we're not just talking about really wealthy individuals staying at a five-star Zurich hotel. These issues around corruption and transparency actually influence lives. So one of the big scandals around the Qatar 2022 is that the infrastructure that's being built there is largely being built by individuals who are being brought from Nepal and largely under forced labor conditions. So they're told that they'll be paid one wage when they leave their home in Nepal, and en route are told that that contract doesn't exist and are given a new contract which has a lower wage. Many of these individuals actually can't leave, even if they could afford to leave Qatar. They can't leave without the permission of their employer. And so this is what we call modern day slavery. It's forced labor. These individuals are working under extreme conditions. In fact, one article quoted that often in the summer in Qatar, it's 45 degrees Celsius, which is about 115 to 120 degrees Fahrenheit. And so in Brazil, it was quite scandalous that it was estimated that one individual per month died in the construction of many of the stadiums in Brazil. And in Qatar, that number is about one per day. So it's just atrocious that lives are being lost as a result of some of this corruption and lack of transparency with regards to FIFA.
Bob, you want to weigh in?
I don't have a lot to add because I think the two of you really covered it extremely well. The point, Tricia, that you brought up about slave labor really truly is unconscionable. I mean, they confiscate their passports. So, I mean, not only do they not have any money, they can't literally just leave the country. I think another thing, though, when you get into the whole geopolitics of this is soccer is truly the world's game. People care. People truly care. And you know, I've had opportunities to sit with people from the developing world while their team was competing in the World Cup. Even if they had no real chance of winning the match, let alone the whole cup, people cared so much. And I think, Lorenzo, this kind of gets at what you're talking about. Now that it seemed to be pure and it seemed to be sport, but now it's so tarnished that I think it really is kind of dash the dreams of a lot of people. So it's very, very sad that way, just from an emotional standpoint. And then, you know, one last thing I'd like to mention, Steph Blatter saying, well, I'm shocked. I didn't realize this would happen. Well, if you recall, we had an executive here in the U.S. Several years ago by the name of Ken Lay, who basically used the same defense when his company, Enron, fell apart, basically for falsifying its financials. He said, I don't know. And as a result, we have a law now in the U.S. called Sarbanes-Oxley that was basically written so that the Ken Lays of the world, and it doesn't apply to Steph Blatter, but the Ken Lays of the world couldn't say, I don't know. And I truly believe, from an ethical standpoint, it is the most senior executive's responsibility to not necessarily have a grasp of every minute detail, but with certainly things like the way these contracts were awarded for both Russia and Qatar, that senior executive should know that, and that is a terrible excuse. Well, I didn't know. And again, we're trying to combat that in this country. It's too bad that there's nothing like that, as Tricia points out, for international nonprofit bodies.
You know, I think these first two cases that we talked are two examples of very common situation in these cases. Lack of any independent representation on the board, any lack of any independent oversight and accountability. FIFA had none. The Volkswagen Supervisory Board had none. I think there's a lesson here. Well, once again, I think FIFA is going to be around for a while. We may have a chance to revisit in a couple of months. You know, it's hard to view any network evening news program anymore without seeing a plethora of ads for prescription medicines for very specific diseases. If you then look up the pricing of these drugs, you discover that purchasing a treatment regimen could cost you or your insurance companies as much as upwards of $250,000 a year. And then even if the insurance covered most of the cost, a patient's out-of-pocket expenses could easily exceed $10,000 a year. Now, this isn't just the antics of an amoral former hedge fund guy like Martin Shkreli and his Turing pharmaceutical company. No, this involves very established, traditional, otherwise very well-respected companies like Bristol-Myers, Novartis, Eli Lilly, Pfizer, and so on. In addition, many pharmaceutical companies are now regularly raising the prices of prescription drugs that have been around for a long time, even, in double-digit percentage increments, at least every year and sometimes more often. So, Tricia, in this era of spiraling healthcare costs and a rapidly growing elder population more in need of such prescription drugs, how can these companies and their senior executives rationalize the ethics of such pricing strategies?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting issue, and there's a couple of responses that you often see from drug companies. And one is that many companies will point to the fact that creating these drugs is a very expensive process. The number of years involved and the amount of research and development, and so they encourage individuals to think about the long term. And by long term, what they're really referring to is once these drugs are come off their patent and there's a generic version, then the price will presumably drop. That, of course, is a very unconvincing argument to somebody who may need the drug today and can't wait 15 years for that drug to drop in price. The other interesting response that you'll often hear is that it would force pharmaceutical companies to cut their research and development, essentially that they're charging these higher prices to support the industry and to support the development of new and very needed drugs. But we know there's a couple of responses to this. So A, we know that pharmaceutical companies spend their money elsewhere. You mentioned the advertisements that most Americans see. And on average, actually, Americans watch 9 pharmaceutical ads per day. That's the average number. And so this is actually in response to some regulatory changes that happened in the mid to late 1990s when the FDA relaxed some of the rules on advertising for pharmaceutical companies. And so over the decade between 1997 and 2007, spending on advertisement actually quadrupled for the pharmaceutical industry, topping $5 billion in 2007. And so, what does this mean for us? There's a few things to keep in mind. One, even though you know that you see lots of advertisements about pharma, this is unique to being either in the US or in New Zealand. So the United States is actually just one of 2 countries that allows for this direct-to-consumer marketing by pharmaceutical companies. And still, it's actually a fraction of what drug companies spend in their marketing and scale and sales. So in 2012, they spent more than $3 billion a year marketing to consumers, and there was a bit of a drop-off there after the financial crisis. But they actually spend an estimated $24 billion marketing directly to healthcare professionals, so your doctors and nurses that you see when you go for your visit. Now, that's in response to sort of this idea that that it would force them to cut research and development. So one argument is that, we could take what pharmaceutical companies are spending on advertising and push it back to R&D. In terms of the pricing, though, that you mentioned, there are a few interesting considerations to think about. One is that there are very few opportunities, really, for these blockbuster drugs. That is, those drugs that are necessary and needed by a widespread or a large percentage of the population. And so in some senses, that's required companies to increase the price of existing drugs that are quite popular. And so, you know, this doesn't make a lot of sense because there's no additional R&D necessary for an existing drug. And presumably, the manufacturing costs wouldn't exponentially rise in its third or fourth year. And so there's something else happening here with regards to the pricing component. And so an interesting study actually found that of the 20 leading global drug companies last year, 80% of its growth in net profits actually stemmed from price increases in the US. So you ask yourself, why is this happening in the United States? And the answer actually is that our system is quite fragmented. So unlike other developed countries where the government provides universal health care and actually is the main negotiator with pharmaceutical companies, in the US, our government is one provider, but it's one of many. Not only is it one of many, it's actually unable to negotiate prices with pharmaceutical companies. So in 2006, in order to garner the support of the pharmaceutical industry for Medicare Plan B, the government actually agreed to forego any negotiating power. So they're unable to negotiate prices with pharmaceutical companies. And so what this means in terms of our pocketbook is that consumers pay a lot more in the US. So a recent study by the Wall Street Journal found that of the top 40 drugs used, 28 are less expensive in Ontario than they would be in the United States. 37 of the 40 were less expensive in Norway, and 39 of the 40 were less expensive were you to go to the United Kingdom to purchase those. And so it's interesting because this is happening at a time and consumers are paying more out of pocket, as you mentioned, at a time when pharmaceutical and biotechnology companies are highly profitable. So those companies in the S&P 1500 earn an average net profit of 16% compared with the average market gain of about 7% for all companies in that index. And so, you know, the US individuals are spending more money on healthcare than other nations, and actually we're doing so in a very inefficient manner. We have worse health outcomes when we're compared with many of our developed nations. So infant mortality, for example, is nearly double that of the average for OECD countries in the United States. People are shocked to hear that, but it's quite true. And so you have this price increase contributing dramatically to healthcare. And the people who are hit, which some of the news coverage has mentioned this, is not only middle-income folks who are paying more out of pocket for their health care but aren't eligible or are making too much money for some of the programs that many of the pharmaceutical companies have to offset costs, but then you're thinking about lower or fixed-income individuals who are paying these deductibles and very, very high copays. And some are foregoing the treatments that they need because they're so costly. I'll just end by saying, you know, Walter Cronkite years ago said, quote, "America's healthcare system is neither healthy, caring, nor a system." And I think his comment still resonates quite well today.
Bud, what do you think?
Well, I think Trisha is absolutely right. I mean, I think you're so right on. And, you know, let's talk about a couple of things. Talking about price increases. One of the things that the pharmaceutical industry has relied on for years was what were known as blockbuster drugs. Lipitor, for example, was a blockbuster drug. At its height, it was doing over $14 billion in sales a year. Now, think about that. How many companies would like to be a billion or a $2 billion in total sales? Here was a company that had one product doing $14 billion in sales. And what's happened is that most of the R&D pipelines in the big pharma companies have dried up. And I and a lot of other people in the industry believe there's going to need to be a huge scientific breakthrough before you find any more of these truly blockbuster drugs. So when the investors of pharmaceutical companies are used to these double-digit returns, as Trisha pointed out, the pharmaceutical executives are under tremendous pressure to deliver profitability. If you don't have any new products, one of the things that you can do is raise prices on an existing product. And that's one of the main reasons that the industry is raising prices on its existing products is because, again, people do need the products And then they also, a lot of times, the thinking goes, well, the insurance company will pay for it. The insurance companies are paying for less and less. As again, as Tricia pointed out, you get into a situation where people can't afford to take their drugs. In the industry, if you don't take your drug as prescribed, that's known as adherence. If you're supposed to take a pill once a day and you take it once a day, you are adhering. If you're supposed to take it once a day and you take it every other day because you'd rather stretch out one prescription over 2 months, you are not adhering. Pharmaceutical companies spend millions of dollars every year trying to figure out how to better get patients to adhere. A simple answer, if I was listening to Tricia, might be, well, to make the products maybe a little more cost-effective for people. Another topic that I'd like to talk about, and I think, again, Tricia's absolutely right, is the Pharmaceutical Research and Manufacturers Organization, it's called PhRMA, Association, excuse me, PhRMA, spends zillions of dollars on lobbying. And a lot of people, and somebody like Bernie Sanders would say, they have written the laws regarding direct-to-consumer advertising, as well as the law that basically says the government cannot negotiate for prescription discounts for both Medicare and Medicaid. And if you think about it, that's kind of crazy. Any super large customer has a lot of bargaining power, and in this particular case, the government is the largest customer of pharmaceutical products. Yet by law, they are restricted from actually being able to negotiate prices with the pharmaceutical companies. So from an ethical perspective, it gets into a lot of the lobbying that's involved, and the fact that a lot of people will even say that the pharmaceutical industry actually wrote a lot of the legislation that got passed that enabled direct-to-consumer advertising, and also, more importantly, at least from a cost perspective, created the situation where the government is hamstrung in its ability to negotiate lower prices for Medicare and Medicaid patients for drugs. You know, another thing Tricia talked about is that I think it was a good percentage of drugs were cheaper in Ontario. If you get to some of the border states with the U.S. and Canada, there are people who run tours over the border so U.S. citizens can take their prescriptions and have them filled in Canada because the pricing is so much lower. Now, that's actually illegal, but people are doing it because, again, it gets into the idea of elderly people on fixed incomes who can't afford the copays for the prescriptions here in the country. It's a huge issue for the industry. It's an issue that has always liked to say, why is this happening to us? We're doing such great things. We're producing these wonderful medicines. And other people are saying, yeah, but you're producing them and selling them at such a high cost that a lot of people can't really get the medication that they need to be able to be to live healthy and happier lives. So I really do believe it's a huge ethical issue for the pharmaceutical companies, and I think it's going to become an even bigger political issue as we go forward in terms of how drugs are going to be developed and paid for.
Yeah, look, I think that the R&D issue, it is a valid issue. I do scientific research, and I know the frustration of people not understanding the value of it, and the research that I do is not even close to be as viral as the research that the pharmaceutical company actually do. It is, to me, disappointing, the advertising aspect that Tricia talked about and how the money actually is not spent in R&D, but is spent on something else. Some of the articles that I ran across preparing for this actually show that people die more in this country for drug overdose, 52% due to prescription drugs than car accidents. And that, to me, is just driven by this culture of seeing and watching 9 ads per day of drugs, thinking that I can solve all my problems by taking a pill. Well, that's false, that's untrue, that's not serving anybody. I do believe, though, and I'm optimistic for two reasons. One is that because we are talking about this, we have candidates from both spectrum that are putting forward proposals about this. There are issues that some candidates don't even want to talk about. This is not one of those issues. This is an issue where we are debating in this country, and it's actually a good sign to me that something will change, hopefully for the better. And the second reason why I'm optimistic, and we have been hearing so much about we cannot do this by law, we can do this by law, and to me, regulations stifle innovation, and I strongly believe in disruptive innovation. And so I don't want to come across as naive, but I want to come across as a little bit idealistic here and hoping that there is going to be a player that is going to come into this industry if we create more reasonable regulation and not regulation just created ad hoc for 1 year or to please certain political donors, but regulation that are fair. Within those regulations, I do believe that the solution could come actually from the industry itself. And I challenge the industry itself to think about innovative way to deal with the problem that is specific, maybe, of that specific industry. But it's a business problem, and those are the people, those business people are the people that maybe could come forward with ideas that are innovative. It's of today the news that at the World Economic Forum, there was a declaration by 80 pharmaceutical companies about the urgency to get money to fund antibiotics research, because it's been pharmaceutical companies stopped doing this type of research, and the threat is that millions of people in the foreseeable future will die because of bacteria that have been developed and we don't have antibiotics for. Well, that's good to know, but the problem, again, it's a business problem, and so I will relaunch to them. I'm curious to know what from business standpoint that they are proposing to do to face this issue that is definitely an important issue.
You know, Lorenzo, when you talk about industry and disruptive innovation, let me give you an example of, I think, some of the craziness that goes on. One of the big health problems in this country these days is addiction. A lot of it is due to opioid addiction because opioids are prescribed for pain. And what happens is a lot of the opioid products are highly promoted, and doctors are, you know, prescribing them pretty freely. And it's constantly mentioned, the problem with addiction, particularly actually in rural America. The interesting thing that's happened is one of the responses to opioid addiction, instead of taking a look at how can we develop a pain reliever that isn't addictive, there is a new product on the market right now that treats a side effect of opioids, which is opioid constipation. It's called it's a new disease. It's called OIC, opioid-induced constipation. So you had a company spend millions of dollars developing a product to treat a side effect of a drug that generally is agreed is not a good thing and is causing an addiction problem in this country. And I think that that's what you're talking about. If we start to look at innovative ways of addressing the problem, we're not going to figure out how to address opioid-induced constipation. We're going to figure out how to provide painkillers that actually aren't addictive.
Let me weigh in on this, because as I think we all know, this opioid addiction has left in its wake a huge heroin addiction problem, mm-hmm. because heroin is cheaper than the opioids. So with a stroke of a pen, the people producing these opioids medication can fix that problem by reducing the price of the opioids below the price of heroin. And I think that's a very worthwhile price competitive move. And it's simple, and it doesn't involve regulation. It's just the right thing to do.
Well, the way the opioids lead to heroin addiction are that doctors are monitored very closely for how they prescribe opioids. So at a certain point, if somebody becomes addicted and is taking, say, two or three times the prescribed amount during the day, the doctor won't give them a new prescription. Apparently, it's quite easy to go to the street and get heroin, which gives you the same effect as an opioid. And that's why you are finding, as Dan's pointing out, the heroin problem that's related to opioids is because doctors won't they will continue to prescribe, but they won't prescribe two prescriptions in 1 month. People will sometimes over medicate, and then they become more addicted, which then leads them to getting into the whole issue of going to heroin. And I think, Dan, that's actually a very good solution there. Reduce the price of the opioids.
I mean,
and you solve that problem.
I'm glad that I don't know anything about drug abuse. But what I know is that is an incremental innovation. So you build on something that has already exists and trying to get additional dollar margin out of creating a new segment. What I'm thinking is it's really bold, and I don't know what I'm thinking at exactly because I'm not a disruptive innovator, but I hope that there will be any disruptive innovation in this industry. Something like SpaceX and space exploration, somebody that figured how to go to space actually cheaper than what we were spending. So that's my idea out there that it's good that we are talking about this, and I really hope that the industry will figure out, not the people maybe in the industry right now, but from within the industry, there will be a solution for this problem, which is, a very, very crucial problem.
And, you know, I mean, it is time for the industry to reflect on its purpose. So, the current business model is really set up by which they're making money on each drug that they sell. So the incentive is to create a drug for the side effect, not a drug that actually addresses the issue. You know, and a couple of things occur to me. One is that I'm reminded the person who discovered penicillin actually said, no, I can't patent this. This isn't intellectual property. I'm just combining compounds that already exist. And so the way the pharmaceutical company has drifted, or pharmaceutical industry has sort of drifted into this very tight intellectual property space is distinct from what Lorenzo is talking about, where much of the technology is actually crowdsourced or shared. And so maybe there's opportunity there. The other thing I would say, though, generally, and is just thinking about the ethics of the industry overall. So Johnson & Johnson, some of the big names are really names that they're built on a foundation of improving the lives and longevity of those lives of the people that they provide products for. And that's not the case in all instances in which we were talking about the drug addiction and prescription drug addiction in the United States. And so, it strikes me as ironic, right, that 9 commercials are for specific pharmaceutical products. What if half of those commercials suggested that people get up and walk around the block? let's think about health more holistically, because we know for a fact that you can't solve all issues with a pill. Some of it is about, exercise. Some of it is about your social engagement and the broader network that you have supporting you in your community. And so, if pharmaceutical companies thought about health of a population more holistically, they may change their perspective and the services that they offer as well, and the products and sort of the nature of the business model overall.
The really cynical view, and I've heard this espoused by many, is that pharmaceuticals are not in the healthcare business, they are in the sickness business. Pharmaceutical companies want you to be sick so that you buy their products. I think that's overly cynical, but there are people who believe that, and it goes exactly to what Tricia's saying.
Let me exercise my prerogative as being kind of the moderator of this, but take advantage of the opportunity for one last comment. Every time I get it thinking about this issue, I start to thinking about some individual, probably an executive vice president for marketing, who eventually has to sign off on this pricing strategy. And what goes through this person's mind? He knows what the R&D costs that have to be amortized over this, and he knows what the operating, what the manufacturing costs and all that kind of thing. And I wonder if it even comes to his head that this $250,000 a month prescription, for a drug that has to be taken for several years, is going to dramatically drive up healthcare costs because everybody else, all the other companies are doing it, and there's hundreds of these things. One of the major problems facing this company, and this is going to drive it up substantially. It's going to put huge pressure on people who have to pay the copays and the deductibles, could absorb a huge proportion of their discretionary income. Or maybe they don't take the medicine and end up not feeling good, maybe passing away. How can they weigh those and say, well, it's more important that we make our quarterly earnings? I mean, how does a person come to that kind of conclusion? I don't know. And with that, I'm going to close this conversation off. Thank you very much. We're going to do a few quick hit questions here. I'll ask the question, and we'll ask each one of the panelists to give a quick quick response, kind of a one-thought response. So the first issue has to do with a young man named Howard Warren Buffett. He is the grandson of Warren Buffett, the founder of Berkshire Hathaway Corporation. He and a partner have co-founded a permanently capitalized operating company that's going to focus on early stage and underdeveloped companies that are working on issues like clean energy, sustainable agriculture, and water scarcity. The younger Buffett told the Wall Street Journal, quote, "I'm looking for the sweet spot. How do we improve society with these investments?" So, panel, what do you think? A well-capitalized ideal, naive idealism, or an opportunity for some investors to greenwash some cash, excess cash, or a likely success given who's behind it? Bud, what do you think?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both. I don't know if it's naive. I do think that he has enough money where he can be in it for the long term with he and his partner with the companies that he develops. The other side of it, I mean, he has the right name. I think that he can attract capital and investors, and he can also look for companies that are not going to generate profit in the short term. So I think it's a great idea.
Lorenzo?
Yeah, I applaud the attempt. I think it's great to have an opportunity to invest in your values. I think that this is appealing to a larger than ever and growing segment of the investor community. I think that values drive business more than what we tend to think. And this example, it's a great example because of the name which is behind it. And so we can quote it and we can talk about it. I also think from a personal and professional perspective, from an accounting and financial perspective, that it's interesting this use of the permanently capitalized structure to invest in this type of investments. We know that the most famous Warren Buffett is willing to invest in pretty much established companies that are capable potentially to generate a lot of cash. This is a very different idea. So this is looking at investing in startup or initial phases company that have actually the potential to generate a lot of losses. So I'm very much look forward to seeing how this is going to play out, how this permanently capitalized structure is going to work in this specific with the specific investment strategy.
Trish, what do you think?
I think it's too early to tell with regards to your question, but I would say that, you know, I'm interested as well to sort of follow the story. As Lorenzo mentioned, there's an increased interest and also just money in terms of socially responsible investing. So he's sort of hitting this at the right time. We see benefit corporations popping up around the country. But the, I think, most exciting thing is to sort of see somebody out there talking about these issues from a systems perspective. So recognizing that business as we know it is going to have to fundamentally change if we're living in a warmer climate where we have concerns about the way we normally produce energy and the ability and access to clean water. And so these are issues that I'm happy to see somebody who's trying to put some money behind.
Yeah. Well, I'll close by saying I applaud the younger Buffett as well. Good luck. All right, so I'm going to start this one with several questions. Should entrepreneurs lie to their funders? Should they lie to their customers? Should entrepreneurs lie to their investors? These are actual questions that were put to a panel of very successful Silicon Valley venture capitalists by a well-known business ethicist and reported recently in the Wall Street Journal. on a full page print, by the way. Personally, I was taught a long time ago that intentional lying to another person was just flat wrong. So why would somebody even ask such a question? Do entrepreneurs live under some different set of ethical standards than other businesses and other business people who know it's wrong to intentionally deceive funders and customers and investors? What do you think, Lorenzo?
Well, the short answer to your question is no. but let me comment a little bit on this, because the old article was very bizarre. I did not understand what the purpose of the article was. I guess it was the attempt to warn, I guess, potential entrepreneurs of the tougher decisions that they will have to make. But I honestly thought it was also kind of bothering that was coming from business professor. It's almost like people wanting to entering into the medical field, and you're going to tell them, you know, a lot of people are going to die because you're going to make mistakes. And it's bizarre. It's like to tell my students that business is dangerous, you know, it's inherently unethical, or inherently we should decide whom to lie to. And I think that was very bizarre. I want to tell very loud and clear to my students that business is great, that business gives you the opportunity to solve huge problems. I found it also very bizarre, the opening and the closing of the article, because in the opening, there is this whole issue of if you become an entrepreneur, your family is going to suffer. And the closing issue is like a quotation from an entrepreneur saying, finally, I can go off and save the world once I'm done doing business. And I think that's crazy. That's very bizarre. I want to again tell my students and tell everybody that I am in business because it is the contribution that I want to give to improve and better this world. It's not only it's not in contradiction, but it's actually a great way to contribute to improve this world.
Trish?
You know, begin as you intend to continue. So, you know, I think in many ways, potentially the purpose of the article was to sort of bring up some of these issues for folks thinking that they want to go into the entrepreneur space. But I think it just reminds me of Clay Christensen's book, where he says that you should never have to check your values at the door. So if you feel like you're making choices in the workplace that you wouldn't make with your friends or with your family, then you need to rethink that.
Bud.
I've been an entrepreneur since 1988, and I just think lying is just plain flat wrong. And when I read this and I was listening to Dan speak about it, it reminded me of a friend who was graduated of the U.S. Military Academy. And the honor code is a cadet will not lie, cheat, or steal, nor tolerate others who do. And I would adapt that. I would say an entrepreneur shouldn't lie, cheat, or steal, nor should they tolerate others who do. So I think that I thought it was just a ridiculous article to begin with, and I really do think that we all have the responsibility to be forthright and forthcoming with our customers, our investors, anybody else with whom we're dealing when we're in an entrepreneurial role.
Well, I support all 3 points of view, which happened to be the same point of view. Last year, 7 asset traders from several large global banks were indicted in the LIBOR rate rigging scandal. One of these traders, Tom Hayes, has been tried, found guilty, and had his appeal denied. Mr. Hayes argued that, quote, his behavior while at UBS and at Citigroup was in line with industry standards and that his bosses knew about and condoned his activities. Therefore, he should be released. On the other hand, the appeals court found that, quote, conduct within a particular market has no legal relevance as people are not free to set their own standards. So, Trish, what do you think?
I mean, I think this is a classic example of somebody feeling like they have the sort of ability to make up rules in an industry where it may be accepted and checking their values at the door, to be honest. And so, you know, Tom Hayes is going to spend, his sentence was reduced from 14 to 11 years. He'll spend 11 years in prison. And this is somebody, you know, who was an asset manager and following instructions, presumably. So in some ways, it's a warning for students or sort of mid-level career folks out there who are doing something that they know is wrong. And you don't always get away with it. So 11 years later, we'll see what Mr. Hayes has to say.
Bud?
Well, when I hear Mr. Hayes' argument, I'm kind of reminded of something I heard many times growing up from my mother. But Ma, everybody's doing this. Well, if everybody jumped off a bridge, would you jump off a bridge? And so I always got this idea that that wasn't a very good argument to make, that everybody's doing it. And it sounds like that's the kind of argument that, that Mr. Hayes was making here. Everybody's doing it. My bosses knew about it, so I have no, there should be no real recourse for me. Doing things that are, in this case, illegal and are unethical are just inappropriate. And I really think that I agree totally with what the judge said. No matter what the industry standards may be here, even if they are somewhat at odds with the law, it's up to each individual to respect the law or pay the potential consequences. And 11 years is some pretty serious consequences for a guy like this.
Lorenzo, what do you think?
Yeah, I think this is another case of unethical practice, unfortunately, again, in the financial industry. I do believe that Tom could be a scapegoat, unfortunately, for what's going on in the industry, and is going to pay a very, very high price for his naive behavior. As other naive statement, he made naive statement during the trial, including people just go to work, they don't think what's right and wrong. Stuff like that, to me, again, we can go back and point to the fact that there is a next post justification of unethical practices. But to me also raises an interesting point, which is the fact that we spend so much energy and so many resources in discussing on how to direct people to what is right and disorient them from what is wrong. But we spend so little bit of time and not many resources in dialoguing with people and trying to understand where this right really come from. And that's, to me, an interesting perspective from an organizational perspective, because we can set up all kinds of mechanism, but if the fundamental values are not aligned, then there is always space for that accident to happen and an incident to happen that has the potential to have severe consequences on a lot of other people.
So maybe we ought to recollect, or regather in 11 years or so to spend, and invite Mr. Hayes to join us. Thank you, panel, very much.